He is the celebrity on stage.
Rasi used to be the great hero.
Good evening. On behalf of Indian International Center, I extend a warm welcome to all of you. This evening, we are going to discuss and launch the book, The Dream of Revolution, a biography of Jayaprakash Narayan. To discuss this book, we are joined by an extremely distinguished panel of speakers. Professor Raj Mohan Gandhi, who is joining us online. He's a research professor, Center for South Asian and Middle Eastern Studies, University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, US. Welcome, Mr. Gandhi, and good morning to you, because it's early morning. We are also joined by online by Mr. Om Tanvi, Vice Chancellor, Haridev Joshi University of Journalism and Mass Communication, Jaipur. Welcome, Mr. Tanvi. We have with us in person here Mr. Ajit Jha, Research Editor, Outlook, Mr. Raghu Rai, Veteran Photojournalist, Ms. Narayani Basu, Historian and Analyst, Mr. Suhas Borkar, Editor, Citizens First TV, who is going to moderate the session, and the author of the book, Ms. Sujata Prasad. Welcome. And please request Mr. Borkar to take the discussions forward.
Thank you, Dr. Munshi, for the introductions. Respected Raj Mohanji, Sujata, the author of JP's biography, my friend Om Tanvi, Sri Raghu Rai, Sri Ajit Jha, Ms. Narayani Basu, fellow members of the IIC, ladies and gentlemen. 51 years ago, a student of seventh class walked up to me. I was then in the 11th class of a school in New Delhi. Those days, the final year used to be the 11th class. And I was the editor of the school magazine, Sandesh. That was Sujata here. And she had written an article on Deen Bandhu C.F. Andrews. Deen Bandhu, a friend of the poor, a name given by Gandhiji to Andrews for his contributions to the Indian freedom struggle. Of course, the article was published, and Sujata says that was when her journey as a writer began. Sujata reminded me of this when she presented me a copy of this book. And today we are gathered here for the launch and discussion on Sujata's biography of JP. Through this book, she has carried forward the legacy of her father, Bimal Babu. This is a very opportune time to do this today in the Indian context, because JP's life was woven around the concept of freedom. What is the Indian context, and what has it to do with JP? There is a widespread perception in India today that there is an undeclared emergency, that dissent is being curbed and the media is under siege. A false narrative is being let loose and information is suppressed. Now, JP was in and out of jail, first when he fought against the British imperialism, and second when he fought against our own homegrown dictatorship. I'm referring to the emergency of 1975. JP was convinced that Indira Gandhi was leading the country towards authoritarian rule in which all freedom would be taken away. Now, let me just quickly flag three points which I want to make on JP's life and work. Now, this is just after after Gandhiji's assassination. Now, to quote from Sujata's book, page 91, in February 1948, the Constitution Committee of the Congress decided to outlaw organized groups and parties with independent constitutions from Congress membership. Within a few weeks of the decision, the annual convention of the party held in Nasik between 19th and 21st March 1948, the socialists finally separated from the Congress, unquote. Now I take you to a few days earlier, 11th March, 15th March 1948, 4 days to be exact, before the Nasik convention of the Socialist Party, an introspection is held in Sevagram. Gandhi is gone, who will guide us now? Kal tak Bapu the, aaj rehnumai kaun karega? Remember, this is 6 weeks after Gandhiji's assassination. It is an astonishingly frank and critical introspection. There are 46 participants, including Maulana Azad, Vinoba Bhave, Shankar Rao Dio, R.R. Divakar, Devdas Gandhi, Dr. Praful Chandra Ghosh, Dr. Zakir Hussain, Rajkumari Amrit Kaur, J.B. Kriplani, Suchita Kriplani, Jay Prakash Narayan, Jawaharlal Nehru, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Mridula Sarabhai, among others. At this introspection on March 12th, the meeting is at 4 p.m., JP said the following. I have the details, thanks to Shri Atmaram Sarogi of the Sarva Seva Sangh and a very senior member of IIC who has kindly joined this program from Kolkata. I shall now read a brief excerpt. This excerpt has been translated by Gopal Krishna Gandhi. JP was an activist, I feel, wedded to constructive work and transformative politics. I quote, today there are two points of view at polar opposites. One is that we have now got our government and so we should let that government of ours do everything that needs to be done. There is a very serious flaw in this point of view, JP goes on. Governments work within constraints. It is beyond the power of any government to complete constructive activities to their fullness. Such work requires freedom and independence of means. It requires research, experimentation, and field work. Without these, constructive work would not acquire meaning. All this is beyond the ambit of governments. These are fields in which people have to get interested and involved directly. A strong organization with a comprehensive mandate to involve people's participation is necessary. That would be Gandhiji's way of doing this. It would be necessary to train people in their respective spheres of constructive work and to make arrangements for them to undertake study and research. And as to the different sanghs that are independently going about their work, the common thread between them will be Bapuji's thoughts. Now I go to the second point. JP shunned power and rejected the chance to become the successor of Jawaharlal Nehru. I quote from Ajit Bhattacharya's Jayaprakash Narayan, a political biography published in 1975. Ajit Bhattacharya, as all of you would know, was a senior member of IIC, was a veteran journalist and editor of Everyman's, a journal which had JP's blessings. Now I'm quoting from page 4. The end was near, Bhattacharya is referring to Nehru, when his closest colleague in the cabinet and the man who in fact would succeed him as prime minister, the modest but capable Lal Bahadur Shastri, approached JP. The proposal was that JP would be the next prime minister. But he was not tempted. JP was not tempted, unquote. The third and last point which I make is that JP had exacting moral standards. After Gandhiji's assassination, he in fact asked for the resignation of the government for the symbolic atonement of the evil deed. To quote from Sujata's biography of JP, page 8788, I quote, "In a statement jointly issued with Lohia and Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, we are having this function in a building named after this great socialist. On 3rd February 1948, Jayaprakash stated that the assassin was not one person, but a big and wide conspiracy of organizations like the Hindu Mahasabha, Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, RSS, and the Muslim League. He insisted on the resignation of the government in symbolic atonement of the evil deed. Now, before I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, I would request you to take this book and buy it from outside and take this small token of freedom with you home. Thank you very much. Can we have the launch? If we all can pick up the book and just... Rajmohanji, if you can just display the book. Omji? Yeah. It's not on the screen. Yeah, fine. We don't even have to get up. Yeah. Thank you. So now it's over to the author, Sujata Prasad, who will take you, give you a brief overview, and the especially on the legacy of her dad. She's carried this forward, and you know why she chose this title, "The Dream of Revolution." Sujata.
I must start with a confession that my father's, I was always, throughout my life, I was in awe of my father's scholarship. And but even so, I find it very difficult to see his legacy as an immutable, static possession that only I have the privilege of carrying forward. I think it would be more appropriate to talk about my father's profound engagement with the legacy of the powerful legacy of Jayaprakash Narayan. That inner sense he engaged with even more powerfully or even more closely after his death in 1979. My father headed the Gandhian Institute formed by Jayaprakash Narayan for several years after Jayaprakash Narayan's death. I'll call him JP henceforth, after his death, and fought against incredible odds to retain its autonomy. With the exception of one book that was published in 1964 called Socialism, Sarvodaya and Democracy, my father introduced and edited selections of Jayaprakash Narayan's writing, several selections, the most important of which was perhaps The Revolutionary's Quest, published in 1980. This was followed by another very close assessment of JP's legacy, a comparative assessment in a book that was very quietly brought out, but very elegantly brought out, a book called Gandhi, Nehru, and Jayaprakash, Studies in Leadership. When my father was in his 80s, he very stoically took upon himself the task of editing JP's selected, 10 volumes of JP's selected works, very extremely stoically. But his most ambitious project, that of writing this biography, which was actually a promise he had made to JP way back in 1977, was to come after that. And something that had colonized his consciousness for all these decades came when he had very little time left. My father, My father met Jayaprakash Narayan. You know, this book is actually an ode to memory and its tenacious hold. I want to talk about the time when my father met Jayaprakash Narayan, or at least heard of his audacious escape from the prison after scaling a 17-foot wall. I think he met him a little later in April 1946, when Jayaprakash Narayan had come to the historic Gandhi Maidan after a long period of incarceration. He was speaking. It was his first public speech. And my father was completely mesmerized. From then on, it was a lifelong association. My father must have dealt with an avalanche of JP memories. And these memories were incubated in the home that we shared. So in a sense, I was part of the memories. JP was in and out of our house. My father's semantic and episodic memory was phenomenal. It was flawless. My own memory, when I took over this book, my own memory was rather teenage-like, because most of my memories did belong to the teenage years. And I would say that the space that they occupied was tenuous, extremely fallible. And to an extent, perhaps, you know, even some of it was based on very mushy sort of constructions of what I saw and felt during that time. But my father's prodigious paper trails helped. His notes, the notes that he left behind, were amazing. They helped. Hours and hours of research at the National Archives and the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library certainly helped. And I spent a lot of time at these two places doing what most authors do, wading through stacks and stacks of private papers and other documents. About the title, The Dream of Revolution, the metaphor of the dream gripped me in several ways, but most of all in the way it was linked to Jayaprakash's extraordinary life. When Jayaprakash wrote his prison diary in 1975, he said that he was bitten by the bug of revolution when he was in high school. But the dream only took a consummate space in his life when he was in the heart of resilient capitalism in America, when he was studying in the University of Wisconsin at Madison. He read literature. He was reading a lot of Marxist literature. He read Marx, he read Engels, Lenin, Trotsky, Plekhanov, whatever was available in English. And with the help of a Polish Jewish friend, a vast corpus of literature that belonged to Marxists like Rosa Luxemburg, theoreticians like Karl Kautsky. So this was where he built the sort of theoretical scaffold on which his praxis would be later built, was here at the University of Wisconsin at Madison. When he returned to India in 1929, he joined the Congress, and at Nehru's behest, there was a small research group set up in the Congress, and he started heading it. It seemed like a fairly innocuous space, you know, the small research group. But he used the space to incubate radical ideas. And his whole aim was to radicalize the Congress and to use it as an effective instrument for anti-imperialist and anti-capitalist struggle. This was the time also that he set up a small socialist research group. He started dabbling with overt forms of socialism. And in 1931, with the help of stalwarts like Ramkrishna Benipuri, Rahul Sankratayan, Abdul Bari, Ganga Sharan Sinha, and several others, he set up the Bihar chapter of the Socialist Party. But the real turn, the real change in his life came when in 1932, he was arrested and sent to the Nasik jail. Nasik was a turning point of his life. Many young congressmen, progressive congressmen who were coming of age politically, were lodged here. So names that you would have heard of, Achyut Patwardhan, Meenu Basani, N.G. Gore, Ashok Mehta, all these stalwarts. they associated with other young leaders like Yusuf Mehreli and Narendra Dev, Ram Manohar Lohia, Sampurnanand, Sri Prakash, the list is very big, and Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, associated with them to form a small socialist group within the Congress, which was called the Congress Socialist Party. This party was formed in 1934. In one of the first biographies of Jayaprakash Narayan that I discovered while writing this book, this biography lying in a forgotten corner of the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library is called Towards Struggle. It's a biography written by Yusuf Mehreli. He talks about the days with a great amount of nostalgia. He says that, you know, they all came out of the prison, Jayaprakash more so, with an idea and a vision. And out of this vision was born the Congress Socialist Party. JP was only 32 years old at that time. When he was 34, he turned into a major Marxist theoretician when he published his book, Why Socialism? This is yet another major turning point of his life. Due to the constraints of time, I cannot go through a linear trajectory of the shape, the different ideologies and ideas that shaped his life. But I hope the book brings it out. There were many contradictions too in the way he engaged with politics. And perhaps his dream, the dream of revolution that he always dreamt about, had, you know, went through lots of ups and downs. So I'll just talk about a few of them, and some of them which I feel are riveting, and I'm sure the other experts and scholars present here will take you through the rest of them. But his life, he dreamt of a Marxist dawn. He tried to work for Marxist unity, but his effort failed. This was one dream that failed. Then he somehow, after calling in Why Socialism in the third chapter, he's actually damned Gandhi in several ways. He says that Gandhism is the most dangerous doctrine. And yet by the end of 1930s, he was edging closer and closer to Gandhi. Similarly, he said for most of the 30s and 40s, there was this massive tirade against the coterie that he said was governing Congress, that was anti-labor, anti-peasant, and extremely bourgeois in orientation. He also critiqued this group in the Congress for what he felt was negotiated settlement for partition and for independence. And he felt that this was a compromise of politics, something that he couldn't deal with. He was very edgy. He was extremely edgy all through. And during this phase, this phase turned into some sort of a disenchantment with power politics. He finally relinquished party politics in 1954 at a fairly dramatic Sarvodaya moment in a Sarvodaya conference in Bodh Gaya. And at this was the time when he embraced the Gandhian Bhudan, Gramdan movement that obsessed him, that would obsess him from 1954 to 1971. He was engaging with this movement and dreaming of a party-less grassroots democracy. By the time it was, in the 60s, he had started talking about Gandhi's unfinished revolution. And the social economic revolution that hadn't happened in India post independence, and he started looking at university campuses as possible sites of dissent. In December 1973 in Ponnar, he told students, he addressed a group of students and said, "The time for revolution, boys and girls, is here and now." And then found echoes of 1942 in the political theater of Gujarat and Bihar. The rest, what happened in Bihar and about the Bihar movement, it's so so enmeshed in our memory that it defies the need for recapitulation. But it would be enough to say that his dream of revolution that did lead to a very powerful government getting down to its knees, and it opened up a whole lot of possibilities. But essentially, finally, unfortunately, it remained just what it was, a dream. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sujata, for that overview. Now, can I request Rajmohan ji, who's there thousands of miles away, but he's joining us thanks to the technology. So, and it's early morning. So, Rajmohan ji, thank you very much for joining us. And it's, living those days again when in the emergency you were also targeted. So, over to Rajmohan ji.
Thank you, my good friend Suhas. Greetings to everyone. My regards to everyone. I welcome this fine book, which in less than 230 pages of the main text tells the life story of an extraordinary man, an acute thinker, a calm and persuasive speaker, a daring revolutionary. JP fired up Indians to do bold things in 1942. More than three decades later, he performed the same feat again. I've enjoyed this account of JP's tumultuous yet focused life. I've learned from the book much that I did not know. I like Sujata Prasad's style of writing, fresh, free, uninhibited. Since I knew her father, I have the right to call her Sujata, but at this formal event, I should use her full name. And although she appropriately gives her father first place in the authorship of this book, it seems clear that the bulk of the writing is hers. If I'm mistaken, she can correct me. JP's personality leaps out of this book. So does the powerful character of Prabhavati Behen. I last saw her in 1972 or 73 when she visited her friend, my mother, Lakshmi Dev Das Gandhi in Chennai. That was not long before Prabhavati Behen, a rock for her husband, loved and admired across India, died. This book reminds us too of JP the scholar, the man who learnt his Karl Marx in the US, the lover of great writing in Hindi and in English, the eager reader who could quench his thirst for reading when British rulers gave him long spells in prison. Since historical details are important, I should point out that a statement in this book about the February 1946 mutiny in the Royal Indian Navy is not correct. After mentioning the mutiny, undoubtedly a significant event, the book says on page 73, quote, "The Labour Party that was in power in England was completely rattled. It sent a three-member cabinet mission to India in March 1946 to work on a negotiated settlement of the political question," unquote. The mutiny began in Mumbai on February 19, 1946. The decision to send the three-member cabinet mission to India was taken by Prime Minister Attlee at least 4 weeks earlier. On January 24, Wavell, the Viceroy at the time, received a telegram from London that the British cabinet were going to, quote, "send a delegation of three ministers to negotiate a settlement of the Indian problem," unquote. I'm quoting from page 206 of Wavell's well-known diary, edited by Penderel Moon. Since others too have erroneously assumed a connection between the mutiny and the cabinet mission, I felt to supply this correction. By February 1946, most of the tens of thousands who had been arrested in the Quit India movement of 1942, including Gandhi, Nehru, Azad, and Patel, were out of prison. but not JP, who, as everyone knows, was Quit India's biggest hero. This book supplies details of what JP did in the days before his arrest in 42, of his legendary escape in Hazaribagh, his subsequent revolutionary deeds, and his re-arrest following an unwise journey on the Frontier Mail. When the cabinet mission arrived in Delhi in March 1946 and met Gandhi, one of Gandhi's first demands was that JP and Lohia, who too was still behind bars, should be released. They were released. 20 months later, in November 1947, after independence, Kripalani, the Congress president, resigned. He was not getting on with Nehru or with Patel. Gandhi advised that JP should replace Kripalani. Neither Patel nor Nehru accepted Gandhi's advice. Rajan Babu became the Congress president. JP's reaction when Gandhi was assassinated, JP's diagnosis of the forces behind the assassination are important pieces of history, missing today from so-called social media, missing also from politically correct mass media. By recalling these important facts of history, Sujata Prasad's book performs a valuable service. JP had frequent differences with Gandhi, but their unity was by far the stronger note. Both were certain that India belonged equally and fully to all who lived in India, no matter their faith, ancestry, or language. The two shared other unshakable beliefs, including one, that the poor and the weak have the first claim to the mind of the citizen and to the budget of the state. Two, the individual Indian has the fullest right to think and speak freely, to disagree with the powerful, with the state, with the majority. On these basic questions, JP stood firmly with Gandhi. For JP and for most nationalists in Bihar, Hindu-Muslim partnership remained central goals. Scholars know that the Champaran struggle of 1917 was a joint Hindu-Muslim effort. 3 years later, this book reminds us, in 1920, a speech by Maulana Azad inspired an 18-year-old JP to throw his life into the freedom movement. Much later, after JP and others had formed the Congress Socialist Party, one of JP's closest comrades was Yusuf Mehr Ali, who would die in 1950 at the young age of 46, a big blow to JP, as this book records. Having given this background, allow me to throw out a suggestion for researchers. This book shows that JP had tried to arrest Bihar's communal killings in October 1946. In the sequence of carnage that began in Kolkata on August 16, 1946, and reached its climax in both halves of Punjab in the second half of 1947, these large-scale killings in Bihar were a crucial component. Yet those killings have not been clearly recorded. Recovering that story is a scholarly task that remains. In March 1948, less than 2 months after Gandhi's assassination, JP and his socialist colleagues left the Congress Party. 4 years later, when the socialists lost badly in the elections of 1952, JP lost his hold over the party. A long story then began of highly gifted persons failing to resolve differences among them. This book reminds us that in February 1953, when Nehru and JP held a series of ultimately unsuccessful talks, there were hurtful insinuations that JP wanted to succeed Nehru as Prime Minister. That was the start of a hurt inside JP, culminating in his announcement soon thereafter that he was leaving party politics. We should ask, was it a crime if a thought entered JP's mind, as it had entered thousands of other minds, that JP was a natural successor to Nehru? that a suggestion of this kind disturbed many, including JP, tells us a lot about Indian politics and about JP. Politics anywhere requires a thick, thick skin. JP had the heart of a lion, but he did not have the hide of a rhinoceros. Another reality this book highlights is the sequence of key relationships that did not work out. Nehru JP, Subhash Bose JP, JP Lohia, JP Indira, all four relationships had enormous potential, but they ended in failure. Personal warmth did survive in each case, which was not a small thing. This book informs us that after Indira was defeated in 1977, quote, Jayaprakash went to meet Indira soon after the pledge-taking ceremony at Rajghat. It was an emotional meeting, drenched in tears, unquote. The pattern of failed relationships was sadly repeated in the final year of JP's life. Morarji Desai, Jagjivan Ram, and Charan Singh were the trio to whom destiny gave the chance to strengthen democracy in India. The three were unable to stay together. This failure was a great blow to JP's heart. The last point I wish to make is about the preface in this more than valuable book and about the conclusion. The preface tells us, quote, the fact that JP dreamt impossible dreams, pushed against certitudes, shunned power, and remained an unputdownable dissident all his life is key to his relevance, unquote. The conclusion offers this sentence, quote, stripped of every vestige of self-worth, Jayaprakash died a sad death, unquote. Sujata Prasad will have to pardon me. I don't like leaving JP's company with that sort of final thought. I see heroism in the way JP left us, even in the fact that he was ignored. The outer shell of his dying body was not JP's final message. As the preface told us, his big dreams are what JP symbolized. Dreams where he saw equality plus liberty, roti plus azadi, Hindu-Muslim friendship, India-Pakistan friendship, the rights of the Lok, the Log, the people of India, including the rights of all the people of Kashmir and all the people in Northeast India, for whose rights too JP gave his mind and heart, and of all the people of Asia, including the people of Tibet, Myanmar, of every South Asian country, including Nepal, a land with which he was so closely connected. JP's spectacular life and his death in seeming isolation and neglect highlight his dreams. Will we dream similarly? And will we seek to actualize our dreams? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rajmohanji, for that incisive intervention. Ultimately, Lokniti has to overcome Rajniti. And that's what JP always said. Thank you very much. Now I would request Raghurai ji to come, the veteran photojournalist, who caught that moment, when the police lathi charged and tried to, can I say kill? I mean, it was virtually a killing move on the 4th of November, 1974, exactly 47 years and 4 days ago, and Raghurai ji captured it, and he has put that photo essay, and Sujata has carried it in the book.
Thank you.
Well, where are those magnificent men that we'll think of them and cry our heart out with every successive government and regime, and every year the magnificence is disappearing from our, at least from our part of the world. You know, talking about lathi charge, I remember I was working for the Statesman newspaper, and the Statesman was very important, respected newspaper at that time. So JP Sahab, I met him, and kind and gentle as he was, they were to start at 9 a.m. in the morning to go for a protest to the CM's house. And there was a curfew. So only few people turned up at JP Sahab's house in Kadam Kuan. So they said, let's wait. So we waited and waited, but really just a handful of people were there. But JP Sahab decided, okay, let's move. So we go down, there's a jeep waiting, and there are 6-8 young Yuva Mukti Morcha students, and JP Sahab sits on the front seat with the driver, open jeep. So I asked JP Sahab, can I sit next to the driver? He says, wherever you want. Because I didn't want to miss his expressions, his face. So we started off. Wo kehte hain paas, aap kehte hain dur. So jeep chal padi. और 6-7 युवा मुक्ति मोर्चा के स्टूडेंट्स हमारे पीछे पीछे, पर लोग जो थे वो उस गली में जहाँ जेपी साहब रहते थे वो खिड़कियों में से सब झांक रहे थे. तो सब जो भी जिन्होंने भी देखा जेपी साहब को जाते, सब वेव कर रहे हैं, जेपी साहब वेव बैक कर रहे हैं. तो करते कराते दो लोग, चार लोग आके जुड़ गए, 6-8 लोग और जुड़ गए. जब प्रोसेशन बढ़ता गया तो जब कुछ और आधा घंटा तक प्रोसेशन जीप चलती रही तो कई 100 लोग पीछे हो लिए थे. तब जेपी साहब ने मुड़ के देखा तो उनको भी अच्छा लगा. तो फिर जेपी साहब बोले कि वो नारा लगाओ. तो जो लीडर था, युवा लीडर, उसने कहा कौन सा? उसने कहा देख और दिल्ली की रानी, जनता किसके साथ है. तो ये नारे लगाते हुए जब तक हम वहां पहुंचे, सीएम के घर के करीब बीएसएफ के जवान मौजूद थे. शायद वो जानते भी नहीं थे कि जेपी कौन है और किस वक्त के लीडर हैं. तो जो ही हम जितना करीब पहुंचते गए, बीएसएफ जो थी हमारे ऊपर, हमारे करीब आने लगी. तो क्योंकि मैं, मुझे जेपी साहब ने ये प्रिविलेज दिया था कि मैं जीप में बैठ सकता हूं, तो आई वाज क्लोजेस्ट टू द सिचुएशन एज इट वाज डेवलपिंग. और फिर जेपी साहब ने फैसला किया कि ये जाने नहीं दे रहे तो मैं उतर के जाऊंगा. तो जेपी साहब उतर पड़े. तब तक जो बीएसएफ के कुछ सरदार लोग थे जो जानते नहीं थे, एक ने डंडा उठाया जेपी साहब की तरफ. तो सच बात यह है कि पुलिस ऑफिसर जो इंचार्ज था उसने रोका. लेकिन बात यह है कि तुम्हारे पिता, तुम्हारे बुजुर्ग पे तुमने हाथ उठाया, मारा या ना मारा, वो बात दूसरी है. तो वो तस्वीर जो थी डंडा उठाए हुए मैंने पटना से भेजी, हमारे स्टेट्समैन में छपी। नेक्स्ट डे गवर्नमेंट ने डिनाई किया कि ऐसा कुछ नहीं हुआ, तो ऑपोजिशन ने स्टेट्समैन न्यूज़पेपर उनको दिखाया, तो जो मिनिस्टर थे उनको माफ़ी मांगनी पड़ी। रेड मिस्टर रेड्डी वॉज द मिनिस्टर, तो उनको माफ़ी मांगनी पड़ी। तो दूसरे दिन जब मैं वापस आ रहा था दिल्ली पटना से, तो उसी फ्लाइट में सीताराम केसरी भी थे। कहते रघु भाई आपका फोटो तो अच्छा है पर हम आपसे सहमत नहीं हैं। मैंने कहा वाह वाह, फोटो अच्छा भी है और सहमत भी नहीं है। कहते ये एक दिन बैठ के बात करेंगे। मैंने कहा थैंक यू वेरी मच। तो जेपी साहब जो थे उसके बाद उन्होंने मुझे इतना प्यार दिया, मैं जहाँ भी जो भी करने गया, क्योंकि हमने तब फैसला किया स्टेट्समैन बुक करेगा, तो हमारी बुक जो थी इमरजेंसी डिक्लेयर हो गई, हमारे कुछ पेजेस छपे थे तो हमारे वो पेजेस उठा के ले गए। तो फिर जेपी साहब जब अनवेल हुए और वहाँ बॉम्बे में थे अशलोक में, तो मैं उनको फोटोग्राफ करने गया। आई मस्ट से हिज सेंसिटिविटी एंड हिज मैग्निफिसेंस, तो मैं उनको फोटोग्राफ कर रहा हूँ और मुश्किल से वो उठ के बैठे हैं। कहते आपने नाश्ता किया, आप चाय पियोगे मेरे साथ? तो फिर मैंने कहा जेपी साहब मैं सब करके आया हूँ, बहुत मेहरबानी। तो फिर मुझे कहते हैं इंदिरा गांधी आई थी मुझे देखने। देखिए दे स्टूड अगेंस्ट दैट हर, पर फिर भी डिग्निटी कि इंदिरा गांधी आई थी मुझे मिलने के लिए। मैंने कहा वाह वाह साहब ये तो बड़ी खूबसूरत बात है पॉलिटिक्स में। तो वो जमाना जो था हमें लगा कि रिवॉल्यूशन आया और हम फिर से जागे। तो नई सरकार बनी, मैं थोड़े नालायक लोगों में से हूँ जो सर्च जगह पे लास्ट मिनट पे पहुँचता है। तो जब जेपी साहब फैसला कर रहे थे कि कौन प्रधानमंत्री बनेगा, तो जो जनरल मीटिंग हुई वो तो ख़त्म हो गई क्योंकि मैं लेट था, तो उसी वक़्त ठीक मुरारजी देसाई अंदर गए। तो वो मुरारजी देसाई से बातचीत कर रहे हैं और ऐसी कमाल की एक सर्कुलर लाइट पड़ रही थी दीवार पे जिसमें से जेपी साहब निकल रहे थे और मुरारजी देसाई तो बैक से उनके बड़े बड़े कान और उनकी टोपी सारा दिखाई देता था। तो हमने वो तस्वीर छापी। तो दूसरे दिन लोगों ने पूछा तुम्हें कैसे पता चल गया? मैंने कहा भाई मैं तो जो लाइट का जो मौसम बदलता है लाइट से और जो हवाएं बदलती हैं मैं तो उसको स्मेल करके रिस्पॉन्ड करता हूँ, शायद इसलिए मुझे अच्छी तस्वीर मिल गई। तो जेपी साहब जो थे और जो ये बात कही कि नेहरू के बाद उन्होंने चाहा कि वो बने, कितनी सहजता से मुरारजी को उन्होंने हैंडओवर किया, क्या बात थी उस जमाने की, उनकी मैग्निफिसेंस की। फिर उसके बाद एक रिवॉल्यूशन और आया जब हमारे अन्ना हजारे जी ने शुरू की मूवमेंट, तब तो उससे भी बड़ी मूवमेंट लगती थी मुझे। और लोग फैमिली परिवार अपने बच्चे कंधों पे लेके पार्टिसिपेट करते थे और मैं कहता था क्या बात है यार, दिस इज द रिवॉल्यूशन आफ्टर इंडिपेंडेंस, दिस इज व्हाट इज हैपनिंग। वो भी यूं ही चला गया। जैसे हमारी सरकारें हैं वैसे ही हमारे लोग हैं, हमें नींद बहुत जल्दी आ जाती है और जागे रहने की शक्ति, वो मैग्निफिसेंट मैन, ऑल दैट इज गॉन विद इट, यू नो दिस इज द प्रॉब्लम विद इंडिया। और बाकी तो उसकी बड़ी मेहर है। और देखिए कि कमाल की बात यह है कि वो एक अमेरिका से चला था, इधर यू आर विद अस और यू आर विद देम। टुडे दिस इज द स्लोगन ऑफ द डे, इधर यू आर विद अस और यू आर विद देम। वो देम कौन है हम नहीं जानते, वो कोई भी उठ पड़ता है। हम कौन है हम नहीं जानते। तो माहौल इतना बदल चुका है कि वो जमाने बदल गए, वो स्पिरिट बदल गई, those magnificent men and their energy has disappeared from our planet. And this is the tragedy we live in, you know. But certainly, when he passed away, I went back to Patna again. And my God, what love and massive crowds touching and coming and touching his feet, throwing flowers on him and to the cremation. And it was a very amazing experience for me. So I have been lucky enough to be very close to him and get his blessings. Thank you very much.
अब मैं गुजारिश करूंगा ओम थानवी जी से जो हमारे साथ जयपुर से जुड़ रहे हैं वो अपना अपनी बात रखेंगे ओम थानवी जी
धन्यवाद सुहास जी एक तो मैं माफी चाहता हूं कि राजमोहन जी की तरह इतना दूर नहीं हूं मैं दिल्ली आ सकता था पर कुछ कारणों से मैं नहीं आ सका हूं और फिर कल जब आपने कहा कि बोलना भी 5-7 मिनट ही है तो मुझे लगा कि ये तो यहां से भी इतनी बात कह सकता हूं एक तो सुजाता जी को मैं मुबारकबाद देना चाहता हूं कि उन्होंने जेपी के बारे में इतनी शानदार जीवनी लिखी हम लोग अपने क्रांतिकारी लोगों को नायकों को बुलाते चले जा रहे हैं और खासकर इस दौर में जब सचमुच ऐसे लोग छीज गए और जिन परिस्थितियों में क्रांति का नारा की संपूर्ण क्रांति का नारा जेपी ने बुलंद किया आज की परिस्थितियां ज्यादा भयावह हैं इसलिए ऐसे नायकों को याद करना उनकी स्मृति को जगाए रखना उनके काम को उनके आंदोलनों को देखना नए सिरे से देखना नए नजरिए से भी देखना मैं मानता हूं कि वक्त की जरूरत है उन्होंने सुजाता जी ने अपने पिताजी विमल बाबू को भी एक तरह की प्रणति अदा की है जो काम उन्होंने जेपी के बारे में किया उनके संकलित अवदान के बारे में जगह जगह बहुत पर्याप्त उसका उल्लेख पुस्तक में मिलता है और उसका हवाला भी वो विमल जी को बराबर देती चलती हैं और उस काम को इस ढंग से आगे बढ़ाया है ये बड़ी बात है तो किताब बहुत रोचक है बहुत दिलचस्प है और किसी कथा की तरह आप उसको पढ़ते चले जा सकते हैं जबकि बिल्कुल तथ्यों से सराबोर है कहानी नहीं है लेकिन कहानी है भी जेपी की कहानी है और दूसरे साथ में उनके साथ जुड़े आंदोलनों की कहानी भी है हमारे अपने स्वाधीनता आंदोलन की कहानी भी हम उसमें देख सकते हैं इस जीवनी की एक और मुझको खूबसूरती ये भी लगी कि जेपी के साथ साथ प्रभावती जी का भी जीवन जो है वो इसमें झलकता है वरना आमतौर पे ये होता है कि गांधी जी पे आप जीवनी लिखें आप बा पे लिखें तो फिर दोनों को अलग तो नहीं कर सकते हैं लेकिन ध्यान एक नायक पर एक व्यक्तित्व पर जाता है तो दूसरा छूटता चला जाता है हालांकि पुस्तक में आगे जाकर के प्रभावती जी कम दिखाई देती हैं हालांकि 1973 तक तो वो थी हमारे बीच में और फिर भी प्रभावती जी को और खासकर गांधी जी के संपर्क में जब जेपी रहे बहुत अधिक और प्रभावती जी भी बहुत करीब रही वो जो सारा शुरू का जो हिस्सा है पुस्तक का मैं ये मानता हूँ कि प्रभावती जी की उपस्थिति जो है वो बहुत प्रभावित करती है इस पुस्तक में अब जो चीज जो विशेष बात है पुस्तक की किताब की वो ये है कि कई पहलुओं से जेपी को पुस्तक देखती है और जेपी के व्यक्तित्व का विकास हम लोग पुस्तक में बहुत करीब से समझ सकते हैं यानी गांधी के करीब गांधी जी के आंदोलन के साथ तो उसके बाद में उनका मार्क्सवादी तेवर और उसके बाद में नेहरू के साथ लाहौर अधिवेशन में मुलाकात और लव एट फर्स्ट साइट उन्हीं के शब्द इसमें उद्धृत किए गए हैं उसके बाद में उनके साथ थोड़ा दुराव भी अलग पार्टी का बनना फिर पार्टी का बिखरना ये सारी चीजें जो हैं, मैं मानता हूं कि मेरे जैसे व्यक्ति को जो बहुत ज्यादा इस बारे में जानकारी नहीं थी, उस आंदोलन को तो हमने करीब से देखा, बल्कि जेपी जब बीकानेर आए जहां मैं पढ़ता था उस वक्त, तब तो कुर्सी पर ही स्टेशन से उनको लेके आए, वो आंदोलन वो दौर सारा देखा। लेकिन ये सारी चीजें इतिहास के अलग अलग मोड़, अलग अलग पन्ने, अलग अलग पहलू, ये सामने बिल्कुल जिस तरह से चलचित्र की तरह उतरते चले गए, ये मैं मानता हूँ कि इस पुस्तक की उपलब्धि है। नेहरू और जेपी के रिश्ते विशेष रूप से गांधी के उतने नहीं, लोहिया के भी उतने नहीं, लेकिन नेहरू के साथ में काफ़ी जानकारी मिलती है। पर फिर भी मैं मानता हूँ कि थोड़ा और खुलासा इसमें होना चाहिए था कि किस रूप में वो संबंध आगे उनके हुआ। लेकिन फिर भी नेहरू का जिक्र बहुत मिलता है, लोहिया का जिक्र तो मिलता है, लेकिन लोहिया के साथ में जो बाद में एक तरह से जो कहना चाहिए कि विवाद हुआ और फिर पार्टी भी जिस तरीके से बिखरी, उसकी जानकारी नहीं मिलती। मधुलिमे के बारे में भी हम सोचते हैं कि उस दौर के और जो नायक थे उसकी जानकारी थोड़ी इस पुस्तक में मैं सोचता हूँ कि और थोड़ा विस्तार से आ सकती थी। दूसरा, पटेल के बारे में जिन दो लोगों को मैं मानता हूँ कि हमें नए सिरे से देखना चाहिए, पहचानना भी चाहिए, और कई पहलू उनके देखने बाकी, हम देख नहीं पाए हैं। तो जेपी के बारे में तो ये किताब सामने आई है और जितनी आनी चाहिए अभी तक भी नहीं आई है और आनी चाहिए, लेकिन सरदार पटेल के बारे में भी जरूर जो है, और इस पुस्तक के कारण मेरी ये धारणा और प्रबल हुई है कि पटेल के व्यक्तित्व को भी और ढंग से समझना चाहिए, कोई उस उनके अवदान पर, उनके व्यक्तित्व पर, उनके चरित्र पर भी कुछ जानकारी आगे कहीं पे आए। इसमें जिक्र आता है, बहुत साफ साफ जिक्र आता है पुस्तक में कि पटेल को कांग्रेस का लेफ्ट के प्रति जो झुकाव था वो जचा नहीं था, और उनको लगा था कि समाजवादी जो हैं वो कांग्रेस को तोड़ना चाहते हैं। तो ये जो चीज है, और हम सब लोग जानते हैं कि इंडिया मींस फ्रीडम में जो मौलाना अबुल कलाम आजाद ने भी लिखा है कि जिन्ना के बाद में किस तरह से जो पटेल के विचार थे वो किस तरीके से वो एकांगी विचार थे जो सामने आए, बहुत विस्तार से उन्होंने उसका जिक्र किया है। इस पुस्तक में भी ये जो पहलू की तरफ इशारा सुजाता जी ने किया है, मेरा मानना ये है कि इसके ऊपर थोड़ा इसी किताब के इशारे से आगे पटेल के व्यक्तित्व को नए सिरे से समझना चाहिए, और ये कोई अकारण नहीं है कि पटेल को अलग करके और आज के दौर में जो दक्षिणपंथी राजनीति है वो उनको दूसरा लोकनायक बनाने की चेष्टा करती है, लेकिन कई पहलू निकल के आते हैं इस जेपी की जीवनी में जो पटेल को भी दोबारा नए सिरे से समझने की मांग करते हैं। क्योंकि समय कम है, मैं एक बात पे जरूरी मैं सोचता हूँ कि बात करनी चाहिए। इस पुस्तक में तथ्य बहुत हैं और जेपी के जीवन के भी बहुत पहलू इसमें आते हैं, और उसके बाद में जिस तरह से मार्क्सवाद के बाद वापस जो है वो गांधी की तरफ आकर्षित हुए, ऐसे में बहुत से लोगों को जानता हूँ जो मार्क्सवाद से प्रभावित रहे, बल्कि मेरे अपने पत्रकारिता में जो गुरु थे सच्चिदानंद हीरानंद वात्स्यायन, वो तो भगत सिंह और आज़ाद के ग्रुप में थे, 6 साल उन्होंने जेल में भी काटे दिल्ली षड्यंत्र केस में। तो एक बार मैंने उनको कमेंट्री ईस्ट में पूछा था टहलते हुए कि गांधी के बारे में, क्योंकि मैं गांधी विचार से सदा प्रभावित रहा, तो मैंने कहा अब आप क्या सोचते हैं, तो उन्होंने साफ साफ कहा था कि अब हमको लगता है कि हमारा रास्ता गलत था, गांधी का रास्ता ठीक था। ये मुझको प्रसंगवश याद आया। मैंने बहुत से ऐसे मार्क्सवादियों के उदाहरण जमा होते चले जाते हैं सामने, और इस पुस्तक को पढ़ने के बाद में भी, कि बाद में जो है वो वापस सर्वोदय की तरफ जेपी का जो झुकाव हुआ वो बहुत ही खूबसूरत ढंग से इस बात को रखा गया है। और ये जो जो जनता सरकार बनी और जनता सरकार और बाद में उनका सपना एक तरह से टूटा, मेरा मानना है कि उसमें मैं सोचता था कि थोड़ा लेखक को विवेचन भी करना चाहिए कि क्या परिस्थितियां थी, क्या वो जो आंदोलन था, वो आंदोलन माफ कीजिए जो आंदोलन है वो आंदोलन गुजरात से उठा है, बल्कि पुस्तक नरेंद्र मोदी का जिक्र भी उसमें करती है। वहां पे जो आंदोलन उठ खड़ा हुआ, उसके बाद बिहार में आंदोलन आया है, और उसके बाद में वो जो आंदोलन था, उस आंदोलन के बाद में इमरजेंसी और उसके बाद में जनता सरकार का बनना और जनता सरकार का जो प्रयोग है उसका बिखरना, तो उसके उस प्रयोग में ही बिखरने के तत्व छुपे हुए थे, इसको समझना चाहिए। इसमें जब 1974 में नवंबर 4 को जो गांधी मैदान की रैली के लिए जब जेपी जा रहे थे फ्रेजर रोड पर, जब उन पर लाठी चली, उस वक्त उनके बिल्कुल करीब नानाजी देशमुख थे, उनके साथी थे बराबर। और उसके बाद में जो संघर्ष समिति बनाई जिसके अध्यक्ष मोरारजी देसाई को बनाया, उसमें भी सचिव जो है वो नानाजी देशमुख को बनाया था। कि जब सरकार बनी तब जेपी ने ये जरूर कहा कि हाँ ये जो है ये दोहरी सदस्यता नहीं चलेगी, पर इतना मतलब मासूमियत के साथ में आरएसएस को या जनसंघ को उस वक्त नहीं लेना चाहिए था। मेरा सोचना यह है कि इस पहलू के ऊपर बहुत जरूर चर्चा करनी चाहिए, चाहे नानाजी देशमुख हों जिनकी छवि उस वक्त जो हमारे सामने है, बाद में तो उन्होंने दाढ़ी बढ़ा ली थी, लेकिन उस दौर में काली टोपी और नेकर में जो उनकी तस्वीरें छपती थी और बाद में मंत्रिमंडल में भी वो रहे, उसके अलावा जो युवा बहुत से लोग हैं, सुशील मोदी, रविशंकर प्रसाद, वो सारे लोग जो हैं उस वक्त अगर आंदोलन में जुड़ जाते हैं, और कम आंदोलन में कैसे आगे जुड़ जाते हैं हम नहीं जानते। अन्ना आंदोलन को आप देख लें, चाहे आप 84 के दंगों में भी देख लें, आरएसएस के लोग जिस तरह से चले आते हैं उस आंदोलन में लोग चले, इससे जेपी की छवि मैं मानता हूं कि वो थोड़ी आहत हुई है। उस पहलू को समझने की जरूरत है, मुझे नहीं मालूम कि ठीक ठीक तथ्य क्या थे, इतिहासकार उनकी पड़ताल करेंगे, लेकिन इस पुस्तक में जिस तरह से संघ के लोगों का और आरएसएस के लोगों का, बस ये कह देना कि वो एक सांस्कृतिक संगठन है, धीमे धीमे करके हम जानते हैं कि सांस्कृतिक संगठन को न कहके पार्टी जो है वो आरएसएस का एक मंच है, इस तरीके की चीज भी सामने आने लगी। तो ये चीज जो है जयप्रकाश जी को जरूर कहा जाता है कि उन्होंने अगर उसको बढ़ावा नहीं दिया होता या उस वक्त उसको दूर रखा होता तो शायद जो है वो आने वाले वक्त की राजनीति अलग होती। इस बारे में भी पुस्तक में थोड़ा विवेचन होना चाहिए था, विवेचन नहीं हो सका। बहरहाल मैं एक बार फिर उनको बधाई देना चाहता हूं, और बहुत सारे पहलू जो हैं पुस्तक में, क्योंकि इतने कम समय में बहुत बातें नहीं हो सकती हैं, लेकिन साहित्य को लेकर जेपी का प्रेम, पत्रकारों से उनकी दोस्ती, रघुराय जी ने तो खुद अभी अपना बताया, लेकिन आरएनजी के साथ में जो उनकी दोस्ती थी, अग्गे ने उनके लिए एवरीमेंस वीकली निकाला था जिसका जिक्र इसमें है, प्रजानीति भी उसी दौर में निकला था, ये सारे पहलू भी जो हैं जेपी के साथ जो जुड़े हुए हैं वो भी समझने की जरूरत है। सिर्फ उनके आंदोलनों के साथ में इन चीज़ों का महत्व भी कम नहीं है, और वो इस पुस्तक जो किताब है उसकी तरफ देखती है। मैं अभी इतना ही संक्षेप में कहना चाहता हूं, धन्यवाद।
आपका ओके, आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद ओम थानवी जी, आपने अपनी बात रखी और कई जो महत्व के आपने पॉइंट भी उठाए, थैंक यू वेरी मच। अब मैं आई विल रिक्वेस्ट श्री अजीत झा नाउ टू टेक द फ्लोर।
Let me point out what a privilege and pleasure it is to come and talk in front of this august gathering, review this really what I consider a monumental work, and in fact it's an honor because for three personal reasons. I was a student at Jawaharlal Nehru University. I was never a student of Professor Bimal Prasad, but I often met him during lectures those days in JNU. We would have late night lectures, and first lecture that I attended was actually Professor Bipan Chandra, Bimal Prasad and couple of Prabhat Patnaik. They were discussing the national movement, and since then I kept in touch with him. And then when I came back from abroad and joined the Times of India, it was right next to Rajendra Prasad Academy, and Professor Bimal Prasad would make it a point. In fact, Anil Mishra is there in the audience. Both of them would actually hound me, call me in the office saying, come and, present some ideas. And I really developed a personal friendship. Every time I would write an article, Professor Bimal Prasad would say wonderful things about it. And he was so kind and generous. For me, I had just started my career. So it was a great inspiration. So it's a great honor to, you know, basically review a book of scholarship by him. Sujata, of course, is a personal friend almost since the JNU days, and then we've kept in touch, as is Tripurari. So that's the second reason. And third, of course, Jayaprakash Narayan was an icon. I actually missed the JP movement because I was born and raised in West Bengal. So by the time I actually came to Bihar for about 5 years, the JP Andolan was over. And yet I saw the sort of, you know, changes that had taken place in Bihar politics, in various other spheres of Bihar's life, was very visible right after the JP movement. So in a way, I'll just point out right in the beginning that I love the book. I think it's a great work, but I kind of sort of disagree a little bit with the conclusion of it. The conclusion I thought was a bit pessimistic. But before I sort of do that, let me go a little bit into something else that Sujata pointed my attention towards, and that is a barrage of left-wing criticism on JP. Let me not name the persons. Of course, Professor Bipin Chandra had written on JP. Some other sort of younger professors these days have written. And the criticism is the following. The criticism is that today we have the NDA government, the BJP ruling in Delhi. And the criticism is that JP was the one who brought the Jansangh into mainstream politics. Because the Jansangh before that period, before 1977, was somehow stuck in some marginal corner right after the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. And instead of going into at length with that criticism, I think the most of these critics must read this book. And let me point out two reasons why I disagree with the criticism. Number one, if it is true that JP brought Jansangh into mainstream politics and gave it respectability, then what happened in 1984? The Jansangh was basically ended up with two seats in Indian Parliament. This is almost 10 years after the JP agitation began in Bihar. So I think this criticism is absolutely baseless in some ways, and the other thing is the CPM, even some sections of the CPIML in Bihar, certainly the Satyanarayan Singh section, the Bhaiji section. I remember because I was a student those days, a lot of these left-wing poets at that time used to, come and give lectures at the university. And I used to sort of sit and have interacted with many of these leaders. They were all in support of JP. So in a way, in India, I would argue, it was the first time that you had a broad rainbow coalition of the left and the right, the socialist and the Jansangh, the Swatantra Party and CPIM and CPIML, although the communists did support from the outside. The only political party which did not support JP, in fact, ended up calling him at times a fascist instead of calling the government of the day, which imposed emergency fascist, they ended up calling JP fascist. You would see that their historic decline began right after the JP Andolan. The CPI, at one time, the CPI was a great force in Bihar. And, right after the JP movement went on a complete decline. In fact, the party which sided with the 1977, the JP Andolan, rose in West Bengal, CPIM, in Kerala, and in other parts of the country. So I thought squarely one must take this criticism of JP. The thing about JP is that his oeuvre, his sort of shifts between, he was a hardcore Marxist, sort of Leninist at one time, especially when he was a student. I was not aware of some of the factual detail of his, of when he was a student in the US, for example. He moved between almost three or four universities as an undergrad. He started as a chemistry student at Berkeley, barely completed two quarters, didn't have the money to pay back, wash dishes, you know, I was a graduate student in Los Angeles, California. I remember the tough days you go through as a graduate student abroad. So from there, he sort of moved to Iowa. From there, he moved to Wisconsin-Madison that Sujata pointed out, moved from chemistry to sociology. And that's the time when, as Sujata pointed out, he came across a bunch of Marxists from where he sort of learned Marxism and kind of ended up. And remember, this is a very interesting period in American politics. Why? Because this is right before the economic depression of 1929. In fact, it's interesting that JP left the United States because he didn't have a job, he didn't have money. Somehow he moved to London, and from then London, when I think his mother was perhaps very ill, he kind of moves back to India. He sort of misses the economic depression, but he saw the period, I mean, he suffered sort of pangs, you know, unemployment, didn't have money, couldn't study much. In those days, he was really struggling during this period preceding the economic depression. And then, of course, speaker after speaker spoke about, you know, the how he formed the Congress Socialist Party. Why this book is very interesting. I, as a left-winger myself in JNU, we were always told, keep away from personalities. Talk about socioeconomic history. It took me a long time in my own life to actually realize that a story told through, you know, with the background of poverty, socioeconomic history, and other things, but wrapped around a personality makes a better story. I learned it as a journalist. I learned it from one of my teachers, Stanley Wolpert, a historian who wrote several wonderful biographies. And I must say, this particular book has the potential of, you know, a great Stanley Wolpert biography. So in that sense, it's very interesting. It gives us a sketch of this entire period. This entire period is actually, I would call it, a terribly crisis-ridden period. Economic depression, as I mentioned, in the US, by the time JP comes to India, you have, you know, all, I mean, 1942, Bengal famine. Before that, several, the entire sort of, the Congress Socialist Party doesn't happen on its own. There is a sort of searing crisis going on in agriculture, particularly in Bengal, Bihar, in eastern India, other parts of the country as well. But if you remember it later on, by the 60s and 70s, there was severe food scarcity, food riots. In fact, Amartya Sen points out, who's written this great book on 1942 Bengal famine, he and Paul Brass, American political scientist, there is a debate that in the 1960s, for example, there was a famine-like situation in Bihar. Sen doesn't like to call it famine, but the drought, back-to-back droughts in mid-60s, back-to-back drought in 72, 73, at the point when the Bihar and Gujarat movements are about to be launched, there was a total sort of agricultural crisis. And why I find it very interesting, because I am working right now on the farmers' movement and the agricultural crisis that is happening in this country today. And all of us, you know, face it. We have seen a farmers' movement going on in this country for the last 1 year. The economic conditions that this book mentions kind of brings back memories of what it is that happens when popular governments are chosen. You know, Indira Gandhi won that election in 71, after and in 72, 73, though not as she wasn't as victorious, but she did very well in those elections. And right after the elections, you had an agricultural crisis, very similar to the present times, 2014 to 2016. Back-to-back droughts you had in India, almost of the same magnitude that you had in the mid-1960s and in the early 70s, almost comparable, negative agricultural growth rate. So similarly, large-scale unemployment. S.L. Shetty, he had written a great piece at one time, which I think the book quotes somewhere, structural retrogression in the Indian economy, large-scale unemployment, massive inflation. All of us are facing it today again. One could blame the corona crisis for it. One can see that this happened even before corona. You know, things were ending in that way. But the parallels, the historic parallels, what we live today and what happened, what the book captures, are very similar in many ways. In fact, even the rhetoric, if you see the attacks by the administration, Indira Gandhi and, you know, Umashankar Dixit and several leaders towards JP, towards the movement, calling them fascist, calling them anti-national. And it's a very similar rhetoric going on in the country today. So the historic parallel is absolutely fascinating. Sujata did point out that, speakers have spoken about various issues. Let me focus a little bit more on Bihar, where I've traveled a great deal, and I was an editor there for a couple of years of the Times of India. Gandhi started his his movement from Bihar, the Champaran Satyagraha, and then later on, Bihar had a spate of agricultural crisis. Remember, it's part of the permanent settlement, the worst of Jamindari. Other regions, the southern region, the western region, also had terrible feudalism, but much less wretched as in Bihar. In fact, there was not a single ruler in Bihar after independence, but there were almost about 36 Jamindars who stalled the abolition of Zamindari for the longest period. In 1951-52, the government after independence, the government introduced the Zamindari abolition. But in the Patna High Court, there was these lengthy court cases going on almost till the end of the 1950s, led by Darbhanga Maharaja, Hathwa state, several other states of Bihar. As I pointed out, 34 to 36 Zamindars had got together. And many of them were, at that time, of course, some of them were affiliated to the Congress Party. Many of them were members of the Swatantra Party. And they had organized this. So Bihar was a hotbed in a way. And JP had seen that. JP had, during the Naxalite movement, JP had gone to Musahari and spent a long time. In fact, what is interesting about JP, again, to bring back some of the contemporary issues, JP had a very different position on Kashmir, for example. JP at one point, and it's quoted in the book, argued that if majority Kashmiri wants to have independence, what's wrong in that? And he reminded Nehru that in 1946, 47, you had actually mentioned that about the UN declaration. And Nehru is actually rejecting JP, and there is a debate there. And Nehru is saying, I don't think that the majority of Kashmir, because Nehru was a Kashmiri, you know, he's arguing from the other side. And yet you find that the personal respect for each other was commendable. In fact, one could almost argue, and some of the previous speakers had pointed out, Jayaprakash was probably the best prime minister that India never had. If you see the debate at that time, almost everyone thought, including perhaps Nehru, that JP would succeed him. JP kept rejecting that openly. He had given up party politics. So in a way, this book combines the personal with the political. As our iconic photographer Raghu Rai pointed out, that how JP mentions ki Indira ji mujhse milne aayi hui thi. Again, you find massive debate between letters that the book quotes between Indira Gandhi and JP. How at every step JP was opposed to Indira Gandhi, and yet what is interesting is the way JP refers to her. At one stage Indu, then Indira ji, then the Prime Minister Indira Gandhi when he's angry. It's very interesting, and how Indira, at different points of time, despite disagreeing with him, despite police attacks, police atrocities around him, on these, Sarvoday activists, yet comes to meet him for advice at different stages, and her frustration and the way JP deals with her. So what is interesting, what the book is able to bring out, that despite these sort of clashes, ideological clashes between the left and the right, between socialists and, let's say, the conservative wing of the Congress Party, between the syndicate led by Morarji and others, and the left wingers, the socialists, the Sarvodayas on one hand, the Gandhians, and Nehruvian socialism. Yet, despite that tension, there's an element of comfort inside. There's a lot of respect for each other. People disagree with each other. It's almost like what I learned from one of my professors, that when I asked him a question, he said, "I won't give you the answer." Why? Because he said, "I'm teaching you how to think, not what to think." So I find that sort of very interesting, given the fact today, the polarization between the two different wings, let's say the conservatives in India and the radicals, are at a point where the country seems to be almost on the point of breaking apart. That somehow doesn't, the book brings out what was very interesting about the national leaders. In fact, Partho Chatterjee, in one of his latest book, also points out that the notion of non-violence, the notion of consensus, he actually, Partho Chatterjee, calls it very Hindu. I don't know if it is very Hindu, very Indic, I would say. But he says that was common to both Nehru and Mahatma Gandhi and the other leaders of the national movement. So that even if I disagree with you, basically we sort of respect each other. In fact, let me give you a couple of examples. A very interesting example is when the Soviet Union attacks Hungary, 1956, right? And Nehru was actually not critical of the Soviet Union. Total silence. And JP goes abroad and talks to some of the leaders at that time, and Walter Lippmann, the great journalist, points out, "What a disappointment is Mr. Nehru." And then JP comes and criticizes Nehru openly, for not pointing it out. And at that point, Nehru changes his opinion and starts criticizing the Soviet Union. So what I'm saying is the ideological clashes kind of brings out how one updates one's ideas, learns from one's rival, learns from one's opponent, something that the present bunch of leaders must learn from each other. At a time when socialism, Marxism, even Sarvodaya have become pejorative terms, I mean, in the media, for example, or everywhere else, people snigger at the term socialism, both here, and I've seen that happening abroad as well. When I was a student back in the mid-90s, for example, socialism was, very much in the, or even before late 80s, socialism was a respectable term. G.D.H. Cole once said, "Socialism is a hat which everyone wears and shapes according to one's head." Today, socialism has become a term which everyone abhors, which everyone moves away from. Even the socialists don't mention the term socialism anymore. What this book does is it opens our eyes to the great sort of depth that, socialism had, that Marxism had, despite the differences, the clashes between, passionate clashes, in fact. Despite that, you see the robustness of the idea, how it evolved, how it sort of the trajectory of the entire era of socialism. JP somehow embodies personally the changes, the trajectory of India. I mean, as sort of JP moves away, let's say, from hardcore Marxism, socialism, to Gandhianism, Sarvodaya, and later, in fact, because he believed in this consensus, he believed everyone should talk to each other. He even sort of invites the Jansangh and other political parties during the agitation. You find the same changes taking place in India as India moves from a left-wing sort of socialist Nehruvian state to the present Hindutva state. And it is happening partly globally, not universally. In America, you see a reversal. You see the coming of Biden and the return of, in fact, the latest Economist editorial is less an attack on Biden, more attack on the left-wing Democrats within, you know, Biden's coalition. So in America, the tide is turning the other way around. In New Zealand and several other countries, you find in Canada, again, you find socialism taking a new sort of, a completely new face, new hope is coming. But in India, somehow the shift hasn't quite taken place. This book opens our sort of heart, our eyes to the depths with which one could still tackle and, you know, talk to socialist leaders, Sarvodaya leaders, Gandhians. In fact, in the year 2015, while covering Bihar election, I spent a lot of time in some of these Gandhian ashrams in Chakai, in south of Bihar, in other places. And it was an eye-opener for me, the extent to which Gandhianism still lives in this country. And people breathe Gandhianism. Principles, in fact, most of these Gandhian leaders that I met in several of these ashrams, I wasn't aware of it. I was at one time. I remember I had gone once to Nagpur to cover Rajiv Gandhi, one of my earliest sort of forays in journalism. And I had met Abhay Bang and Rani Bang, you know, the sort of Abhay Bang was this leader of the great socialist leader Bang. So I had at that time seen some of the, I had moved around in many of these other ashrams and seen this. But this book is a real eye-opener. I'll just end. Where I find just one word of difference, where I finally differ with the book, I feel that the book somehow, in a very personal way, because it talks about JP, it talks about the kind of the dream dying in the last period of the JP movement. I kind of disagree with it, because I think historically you must assess a book more from a long-term perspective. And if you look at Bihar politics today, in the last 30 years, I would argue, is actually a realignment, a social, political, cultural realignment that has taken place in that state is because of the JP movement. The entire leadership, whether it was Lalu Prasad Yadav, who's now in the opposition, was in power at one time, Nitish Kumar, Ravi Shankar Prasad, even Sushil Modi, all these were at one time students of Patna University, contemporary, all sort of surrounded JP. They were sort of JP's followers. And the Congress has disappeared completely from that state. So this political and social realignment is, I think, in Bihar, and I think in other parts of the country that it has taken place, is actually an outcome of the JP movement. In that sense, JP's ideals, JP's sort of dream still remains with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ajit, for that. It's out of the box kind of a thing which you have said. Well, thank you very much. And then especially how to think, not what to think. You know, that's I think it's very critical in our times. Now I'd request Narayani Basu, please come. She's promised not to take too long.
First of all, thank you, Sujata Prasad, for writing such a fantastic book. I think I'm a few generations younger, so I did not have the pleasure and the privilege of knowing J.P. Narayan, but certainly this book has opened my eyes to a man who was much more than just a revolutionary, and something that was greater than the dream of a revolution. Our speakers have summarized this book and the aspects and perspectives that it covers extremely extensively. What I really appreciated about this book, however, was the personal aspect that was brought out along with the political and the ideological aspect. For me, history is told well only when you actually get to know the facets of an individual and how he brings the political and ideological and his own outlooks on life to the personal. And you saw that coming out so beautifully in Sujata Prasad's biography. You see it in JP's relationship with his wife, who was an incredibly feisty, independent woman with decided views of her own. She was a trenchant critic of his own policies and politics. And yet their marriage was a deeply enduring one. She was the voice of moderation in much of JP's political life and personal life. You also see the portrait of a man who was incredibly principled, who I think the book refers to him as a poster boy of dissent, but he was also somebody who refused to compromise his principles and his integrity for anything. You see it in the way that he shunned identity politics, party politics, the way that he took on and was not afraid to take on leaders of the time. And these were giants of leaders. His debates with Nehru in particular are incredibly eye-opening. They are intellectual. They're two men who are intellectual equals and yet are have a bond, an extremely deep bond of friendship and almost brotherhood. And the book brings out really beautifully how difficult it is to keep that bond alive, particularly when you are two prominent public and political intellectuals. The debates are focused entirely on how the country can be taken forward. And I think this is a point that was mentioned by all of our speakers here about dignity in public discourse and political discourse. And you see it in, you know, in JP's debates with even with Sardar Patel, which, you know, the book refers to as fractious, incendiary, at times frosty. And yet that never allowed, that never kept JP from drifting away from the Congress until 1948. You see it with Gandhi. At the outset, JP was, you know, very much not aligned with Gandhian politics and practices. And yet Gandhi was somebody to whom JP could return if he needed mentorship, if he needed advice. He was a very strong presence in JP's life as well. This is a man who was who led a very, very publicly political life, but also was deep. The relationships that this book brings out are deeply complex. And I think that is one of the beauties of this book, that it doesn't shy away from highlighting the complexities of relationships, of friendships, of how those friendships and relationships are touched by political principles, by personal principles, by ideas of ethics. JP was somebody who brought, you know, the idea of ethics very strongly into his political ideas. And that is something that was at the root of so much discord in his relationships with Nehru, with Indira Gandhi, with Sardar Patel. And yet you see that dignity enduring, you know, when you speak of Indira coming to visit JP, when you see Nehru and JP's correspondence, you know, where there is always this sort of ability to slide under each other's skin because each man knew the other man so well, and yet knew which sort of weak points to sort of hit on. There is, I think, a point where Nehru calls Jayaprakash woolly-minded. And there is this moment where, you know, both of them encounter each other at a political meeting and Nehru is visibly and palpably cold to Jayaprakash. And this hurts him greatly. It hurts Jayaprakash. It hurts Nehru also. So it's actually a very clear-sighted portrait of the personal that lies behind the politics. And I think I'm not going to go too deeply into it because I think this is a book that needs to be read. I also feel, though, that, you know, I know our speakers have talked about the ending of the book and how, you know, the dream is not really dead. But I think the dream is actually something that can be readjusted to suit modern times, honestly speaking. The values that he stood for are the values that I hope most of my generation espouses: communal harmony, you know, bringing minorities together rightfully and respectfully within this country's fabric. Dignity in political discourse, whether it's on social media, whether it's off social media, being respectful in ideological discourse, being able to put the country first as far as your discourse is concerned, rather than mudslinging or petty politics. Those are all principles that are very relevant even today, especially. And I think that this book serves as a reminder to us that Jayaprakash Narayan may be long gone, but his ideas and principles live on. And in that sense, the dream of a revolution can and will be alive as long as we keep that in mind. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Narayan. Now we go to a short Q&A. If there are any questions, and we could also tell our viewers to join in and put your questions on the window, and so that we can pick them up also. The viewers who are watching us on the webcast. So, just identify yourself. Get the mic, please, quick. Yeah.
मेरा नाम अनिल संत है, उत्तर प्रदेश से मैं बिलोंग करता हूँ. जेपी को बहुत नज़दीक से देखने का मौका हम लोगों को मिला है एज स्टूडेंट. एक जिज्ञासा दिमाग में रहती है, वो ये रहती है कि जिम्मेदारी से वो क्यों भागते रहे, क्योंकि कहने के लिए तो वो था कि ही शंड पावर, बट एट द सेम टाइम ही एक्सपेक्टेड एवरीवन टू एक्चुअली आस्क हिम एंड डू व्हाटएवर दे वांटेड टू डू. जैसे गांधी जी को लोग देखते थे और गांधी जी से पूछ के ही हर काम करते थे. यह प्रबल इच्छा उनके दिल में भी थी कि इंदू जी उनसे पूछे और उनसे पूछ के ही काम करें. तो यह कुछ विरोधाभास मुझे दिखाई पड़ा. इसके ऊपर आप प्रकाश डालना चाहेंगे?
सर, वी कैन पिक अप फाइव क्वेश्चंस टुगेदर. तो जरा संक्षिप्त में बोलिएगा, क्योंकि समय थोड़ा निकलता जा रहा है. इज देयर एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? या प्लीज माइक इधर दीजिए. इधर
नमस्कार सभी को. जैसा अजीत झा जी ने बोला कि ये रिमाइंडर है, मैडम ने कहा ये रिमाइंडर है आज के युग में जैसा पहले हुआ था, क्रांति, ड्राउट्स, फार्मर आंदोलन, लाठी चार्ज जैसा आज हो रहा है, तो क्या क्या बुक का कोई फिनोमेना ऐसा भी है?
वो रिपीट करिए, क्या बोला आपने?
मैं कह रहा हूँ कि मैं इंग्लिश में बोल रहा हूँ. What is the political phenomena of this book? Is there any? Then what you think about 2024?
There is some.
Can you identify yourself?
I'm Rajan Raj. I'm a lawyer. So there is some thinking on. The fact that JP's economic and political conception of how the country should go forward was more on Gandhi's lines of being village-centric and on based on self-sufficiency, as opposed to Nehru's statist planned based on the Soviet model of economy. Okay. Is there any thinking out aloud in the book on this? And can it be related to what is happening, say, in farmers' protests today? As in, if we would have gone on JP's model, would it
Fine.
Would things have been different?
Yeah.
Very short question. Being close to those of 1977, the players who were part of the government and who didn't join, one thing disappointed the socialists who were very close to him. And that was, why did he allow a nomination to be the prime minister, nominated by him? Why did he not then force it to be a democratic election between the aspirants? Perhaps that would not have made the 1977 government experiment fail. This has been a question among those socialists I know very strongly, and even those who followed them.
Right. We'll take one more and then.
Can I make a
small point? Yeah. It's a point or a question?
No, not a question. Just a information I'm giving. My name is Amod Kant. I'm an ex-policeman. Just a point that in the discourses, JP related discourses, police comes in extremely bad light. It had to. It always comes. But let me inform you.
Ramanand Tiwari in Bihar, he was the police minister.
I know. No, the one small point I'd like to mention that when emergency was over, and K.F. Rustamji, a very celebrated policeman, he met JP. And let me inform you that the National Police Commission was initiated by JP. It was because of him that the greatest and the mightiest reform process, which hasn't ended anywhere, it hasn't landed up anywhere, but it was because of JP that National Police Commission was created. Thanks. And information is started. Thanks. Just information. Thank you.
Ajit, can you pick up?
Just small question. Just curious. Have you referred to my father's book, Emergency? Kya Sach Kya Jhoot? You didn't. Okay. So I was just curious. Okay. And the last thing that I remember, I'm Rashmi Singh, work for the government, but very fond memories, going there to get the blessings from this man who was like old, fragile. He's not looking happy towards the end. Yeah, he was not happy. So I'm just ending with that. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. I think we'll take it in the next hour. Just keep your hands ready. Maybe a short answer to this.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
sir. Yeah. Right here or is it both
there? No, you can take this here. Okay. Yeah. No, it's on.
Oh, okay. Let me start with that very good question, I think. The political relevance of JP today. In fact, I wanted to talk about it, but I thought I'll get outside the book. But I think JP is very relevant today at a point when, the great thing about what JP brought about, other than the fact that he led the agitation, was how he brought political parties from both the left and the right together on one election symbol. It was the BKD symbol. And a total alliance all across of the opposition leaders, right-wingers, left-wingers. That, I think, we need today for that important question you asked, 2024. We don't see that happening in Uttar Pradesh, for example, in the assembly chunav. It's not happening in the country as a whole. We have some political parties together, but we don't have all of them. And until all of them come together, it's difficult to even challenge the BJP, let alone win. So I think it's a very relevant question. Sir, Mr. Kant, I don't remember police officers, but I think the book mentions Deva Shyam, who was, I think, Commissioner of Chandigarh. That's right.
He's
an IAS officer based in, was in Chandigarh. And even when JP's in the jail, the kind of human relationship that Deva Shyamji had with it sort of mentioned. So it's a very good question that you point. I was not even aware of the fact that JP was.
Okay. The other one about that election instead of democratic election.
It's a very good question, Ma'am Jai Jetli Ji. It's an excellent question because democracy requires internal elections. And all political parties in this country, with rare exceptions, have actually done that. I just have this feeling, and I could be completely wrong because I'm not, in fact, I don't have the political experience that you do, but was there an attempt, this whole notion, I remember in college reading Jean-Jacques Rousseau, this famous French political science, whatever. He pointed out that political parties divide people. Elections, end up sort of exaggerating those divisions. So there it seems a sort of a similar thing happening during the National Independence Movement and the same thing happening at that time when you were asking. They always felt that if the leader nominates, and since the leader is above everyone, it will not bring out the differences. I don't know if this is true, but that's my lurking suspicion. But I completely agree with you. It was a very non-democratic sort of way that the election was conducted. I'm totally in sympathy. And political parties in India need to learn a great deal from that. Is there anything?
There's one more question that we shunned.
I think Sujata and others should answer.
It was hardly an election.
No, not that. The question of a shunning power. You know, that's what he was shy of power.
Shyness of JP.
Fine.
I think he was so, he had become so disenchanted with power politics. I think I pointed that out also when I was speaking. By 1954, he had formally renounced power politics. So yes, this could be said, all through 50s, there was a very strong perception that he was going to be the natural successor of Nehru. And there's a very interesting instance in 1958, when Manchester Guardian, he was returning from Europe, and they a journalist from that newspaper was interviewing him, and he said, JP, what if the country swings, after Nehru, 58, and Nehru was getting increasingly fragile. So the question was that, what if the country after his death swings to extreme left or extreme right? What will you do then? Because, you are sort of sidestepping power all the time. So he said, if that happens, then I'll definitely come center stage to mentor and to guide. But he said, but I'll still not take power, I'll still not, take a seat or. He was beyond that. But he did say that he would come center stage and guide the country and stabilize it.
There's one question left on that, the economic policies and its relevance to the farmer's education. So Ajit will pick that up.
Just a short answer, because I don't think it's sort of, the book actually deals with it at great length, but JP was a Marxist, remember, to begin with, during his early life, right? So in that sense, he was a modernist. He actually believed in the strength of capitalism, the strength of industrialization, unlike Gandhi. JP was not a Luddite, but
Ajit, in fact, Marxism remained with him right till the end. It was an amalgamation of Gandhism and Marxism, which was a very unique amalgamation.
That's right. So, but he does take he's sort of against commerce and its uglier aspects. In the book, I think I saw some references to that. Now, that is a typical, JP was a moral leader. So he was against this crass commercialization. And that's where you find, remember, I'll give you one example. When JP was unemployed, he didn't have a job. I think he was hanging around in Allahabad. He got a job. He took. He had to move out of politics. At that time, he wrote to Gandhiji. And Gandhiji asked Birla. And JP became Birla's secretary in Kolkata, I think. Correct?
Yeah.
And it wasn't that he was against capitalism as such. So if I've answered that question.
That was the particularly unhappy phase of his life. He cribbed a lot about that.
That is true. I mean, yeah, he certainly did not like the excesses of capitalism or the commercialization of capitalism. And in that sense, yes, the farmers' agitation draws its inspiration from, the Sarvodaya leaders, Gandhian ideals. Very good question. Thanks.
Thank you. Now, we'll just go to the second round. I just wanted to say a word that this kind of amalgam of Marxism and Gandhian ideas has been part of the socialist psyche. I remember a book which Madhu Dandavte wrote on Marx and Gandhi together, So anyway, we'll go to the second round now. Yeah, go ahead. At the end of the room. Well, this will be the last round. We'll have to close now.
It's not, this is audible. Huh? Myself, I'm Savi Savarkar. I'm a painter. I have seen some of the posters designed by JP during the JP Andolan also, and he's to guide to the artist very nicely. If you able to incorporate it, such kind of his visual imagery. I don't know the Raghu Roy aware about this or not, but he has a lot of influence of the Chitto Prasad's works on the JP's mindset. And he was a very open person to accept that kind of imagery.
Thank you.
If you incorporate such kind of thing, that book will be will come and give it to the modern insight.
Yeah, give the mic here quick.
This one,
Hi.
Yeah, it's on.
Yeah, hello. I'm Rajni Sekri Sibyl. I'm a writer and was a bureaucrat at some point of time. Now, my question is to you, Sujata. This is on the writing of the book. How much of the book is yours and how much of it is your father's? One. The second thing is that, you know, it's when two people write together, you know, and some of which you must have picked up from him, some of which you must have written on your own. It's not very easy because your styles of writing, the manner in which you actually think and emote and put together the words are different. Was it a challenge? Thanks.
It was, should I reply?
Yeah, yeah.
It was a huge challenge. My father is the DNA of the book. He's the structure on which the book rests. You know, his incredible 10 volumes of selected works, his whole life was modeled on Jayaprakash Narayan's ideas. This 10 volumes was just one part of the immense work, volume of work on Gandhi that he put together. So when I set about writing this book initially, I tried to write it like my father would have, but I abandoned it because we are two very different people, and the way we approach writing, I mean, despite the fact that I admired him deeply and I think there was such a quiet elegance to his writing, but my style was very different. So my publisher, who's sitting right here, Aishwarya, I had discussions with her, and then we decided that the DNA would be there, but the superstructure, the base would be his, but the superstructure would be mine. And that's how it was.
I think we should put this question to Rajmohan ji. He's done so many biographies. I mean, how does this play out? Would you share? I mean, of course, there's nobody else writing apart from you. I mean, you saw all. You are a singular writer, but how does this play out? I mean, this writing a biography. Can you just share this with us?
I will decline this opportunity, dear Suhas. I think Sujata ji has answered the question, precise question, very correct, very precisely, and no further comments are called for.
Okay.
But may I add, you being a lady, I'm sure you'll realize that it's very strange that it was conceived by a man who was so closely associated to JPG. And he delivered the baby and she's brought it up simply.
Hello.
How's that?
There's one there.
So, I also want to just add a little bit. It was my father primarily, but I also want to remember my mother. Her last book was a very simple book where she explored the relationship between Kasturba, Kamla and Prabhavati. This book was brought out by Bani Publication after her death. So I don't, I think it was inevitable that, you know, I mean, I had to write this book. It just...
There's one there, Nina De Gupta.
Actually, we've heard so much about JP's involvement in national democracy, his activism. But I think in the last few years, he was very involved in promoting grassroots democracy because he was running the Panchayat Parishad with another kindred contemporary, S.K. Day, and they were both presidents and vice presidents together running that Panchayat on Insan magazine. Did you do anything about his grassroots interests?
I have actually, and unfortunately, you know, the moderator here gave me some 7 or 8 minutes to speak, but I really did want to speak about this aspect. There was so much
it's
of
all
JP.
Gone now.
There was, you know, he set up the Chhatra Yuva Sangharsh Vahini. This was almost bordering on the time that he fell very sick and died. And one of the most significant movements inland of women was in Bodh Gaya, where the Mahant had control over 1,000 acres of land. So what started as a movement of landless landless workers and sharecroppers to reclaim land that they had tilled for several decades of their life, actually turned into this very strong feminist movement where, you know, women, sharecroppers and women wage workers started questioning gender relationship, and they started demanding equal pattas in land. And JP was a huge supporter of this movement. Had he lived, you know, Bihar would have been different, India would have been different. This is, you know, the first strong, I think it was the strongest movement in South Asia. But there was also another side to it that I have to reflect, which is why that I must talk about. That is why, unfortunately, everybody has said that I've talked about the dream, the death of the dream. But, you know, in 1980, many of these Sanghashwani members, prominent members, some 500 of them were arrested and put into jail by the Bihar government. They were labeled as Naxalites for demanding their basic rights in land and rights as humans. And you know, even while JP was alive, even in the 1978 and 79, he saw where this movement was drifting, and he saw the state unleashing its oppression upon the movement.
Oh, hi.
I think with the... Is there...
Just a last question for the author.
Okay.
Yeah, just that I've come across some accounts of JP in his time in prison, that, and the accounts kind of claim that he had been poisoned. And I wondered in your research if you could just shed some light on that aspect.
So when JP was arrested on 26 June 1975, and he was taken first from the Gandhi Peace Foundation to Sohna, there he felt a murmur, something in his heart. He wasn't feeling well. So he was brought to the All India Institute of Medical Sciences and then flown back to Chandigarh, to PGI Chandigarh, where he was imprisoned. On, I think it was around 1st July, I can't remember the dates, but it was around that time. But you know, it was not a prison, and we must remember this, because I'm also, you know, one has to remember, you know, we are talking about the emergency, and yet look at this, that he was actually taken to PGI, put in a ward space, which was air-conditioned. He had a writing table, he had access to newspaper. Deva Sahayam, the DC of Chandigarh, has said that, you know, when he was imprisoned, then he was given instructions that he should not be allowed visitors, but he was very sympathetic, so he used to sneak in an occasional visitor, and later he was allowed visitors. After a while, he was also shifted because he had a balcony to stroll around in, but he said that he wanted to walk. So he was shifted to the guest house of the PGI, and PGI, as you know, is a super speciality hospital. So every day there was a team of doctors who used to come and attend on JP, you know, used to sort of monitor all his vitals. He was taken to the guest house where he spent a happy sort of, if you can call it happy, but a happy sort of life, reading and writing. And yet, you know, towards the middle or the end of October, he started getting very strong abdominal pains. So today, you know, Dr. Dave has just left. I was so honored that he came. Dr. Dave used to be the director of All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and Dr. Talwar, who was our head of cardiology. I also did 5 years there, so I can't stop saying our cardiology department. Yeah, so Dr. Talwar was also here, and they had a short discussion on this. I asked them exactly this question. I said, what do you feel? So they said that, you know, JP had diabetes for a long time, and although there were a team of diabetologists also looking after him, after his wife died in 73, he sort of stopped, you know, he stopped taking his pills regularly. He just, you know, it was just uncontrolled, his diabetes. So it was affecting his kidneys, and they said that he had a very strong UTI. So anyway, by the time it was, you know, all this is just speculation, but he did get the best medical attention. And in November, early November, when it was pointed out to the government that his health was deteriorating and he may not even survive, he was immediately taken to AIMS. At AIMS, a team of doctors, cardiologists, diabetologists, other doctors were looking after him. Dr. Anoop Saraya is here. He may want to shed some light. But, you know, his brother who was there with him wanted to shift him to Just Lok Hospital in Bombay, and the government allowed that. At Just Lok Hospital, his cardiologist, Dr. Mani, was asked this question by reporters, you know, and he said that look, he's neglected his diabetes, but yes, if he had been brought here earlier, then maybe he, you know, it may not have deteriorated to this level. But, you know, we don't know. There was an ALBA commission set up by the Janata government, but nothing really came out of that.
Can we agree? I think we now, it's been 2 hours. I think we just closed. Yeah. It's just time has passed. So if with your permission, I think we'll close the meeting. It's been a very stimulating evening. Thanks to Sujata and the book. And, you know, this is 2 hours of book discussion. It's a little unprecedented in IIC. So, you know, I was in my MA in St. Stephen's JP came and addressed us in that Morris Nagar chalk, you know, and there was a huge rush and there was not even a sitting space. And then I remember going down to Delhi Gate, the stadium. And then, a friend of mine singing that song, JP Ka Bugle Baja, Ramesh Sharma from the Gandhi Peace Foundation. So, these are memories, I think, as Ajit said, of an iconic man, you know. And you carry these, the younger generation doesn't realize what a kind of, you know, I still remember when we used to come on that DU specials back home. And there would be some buses would cross us, and there would be these youngsters, young guys who were being taken back to Tihar after a court appearance, and we would wave at them, you know. They were heroes for all of us. So that kind of milieu was there right across, and that was all due to this man's, the moral energy which he produced. And this shook us all. And then the government virtually fell, and it was a go-go for JP's MPs to come and form the government. That the government didn't stick so long, that's another matter. But, it was a government which was formed by this iconic figure, virtually. So thank you all for joining us. Thank you, Naraini. Thank you, Ajit. Sujata, of course, the writer, and Raghuji, and thank you very much, Rajmohanji, for joining right across and staying with us all through this morning. And thank you, Omji, for joining us from Jaipur. I think we close now. Thank you very much. Thank you all.